When I'm in the roughest water, I won't go under, I won't drown. And when I'm in over my head, I know that you won't let me down. And when I'm broken and down to nothing, I know that you are always up to something good. I know that you are always up to something good. You'll make a way, whatever it takes. There's nothing your love won't endure. I know that you are always up to something good. Even through the deepest valley, you go before me, you are here. For I know you'll never leave me, your love surrounds me, I won't fear. And when I'm broken and down to nothing, I know that you are always up to something good. I know that you are always up to something good. And you'll make a way, whatever it takes. There's nothing your love won't endure. I know that you are always up to something good. The darkest night, you are on my side. You are always faithful. Through my fear and doubt, you will lead me out. You are always able. Through the darkest night, you are on my side. You are always faithful. And through my fear and doubt, you will lead me out. You are always able. You are faithful. I know that you are always up to something good. And I know that you are always up to something good. And you'll make a way. Whatever it takes, there's nothing your love won't endure. I know that you are always up to something good. And you make a way. Whatever it takes, there's nothing your love won't endure. I know that you are always up to something good.
Yes, yes, he's always up to something good, and he's up to something good today in your life, in my life, in this church, in this community, in this area. And guys, here's the great thing about it. This is just what I've really enjoyed about Pastor Zach's sermon series on Blessed, is God is just waiting to bless us. He's just waiting to pour out these blessings on his children. And what I love about it is, like, Pastor Zach has given us these like practical steps. Like, if you want to be blessed, do this. And it's not Zach's words, it's God's words. He's explaining them to us. And I've been so blessed by this series. I can't wait just to see where it goes from here. And what I can't wait for is to start to see those blessings rolling back into this church body and into this building, as next week is Friend Day. And we've been out there, we've been inviting friends, we've been talking to people. You need to come check this out. You need to come check this out. I talked to a young man, or not a young man, an older gentleman, down in Jacksonville this week. I was down there in one of the businesses, and he's like, hey, where do you live? Where do you live? I'm Fernandina Beach. He goes, oh, I was born at a little house on 2nd Street, just right off of Center. And he's like, and that house is still there. I'm like, oh, well, I work at First Baptist Church. He goes, great church, great church. I'm like, well, we actually built a new building a while back and everything. He goes, oh, they're not downtown anymore. No, the new building, everything. He goes, that's incredible. That's incredible. What I can't wait is to see the blessings that come in generation after generation because of the faithfulness of you guys that are here today. And next week, as we're faithful to invite our friends and invite the people that are in our lives to come and not just be a part of an event here, but have the opportunity to meet Christ in a real way. That's what I'm excited about.
Water you turned into wine, you opened the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, there's none like you. Into the darkness you shine, and out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, there's none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Into the darkness to shine, and out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, there's none like you. And our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher. For us, then who could stand against us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against us? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against?
For us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is
could remember no wrongs we have done. Omniscient, all-knowing, he counts not the sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy. What Father so tender is calling us home. He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood with the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more.
Are you hurting and broken with it, and overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. And have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling.
Let's all sing together.
Come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait, 'cause Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. And oh, come to the altar.
Time just together.
And oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Matthew chapter 5, verse 9. If you have your copy of God's Word or an app, go ahead and open it up there. Matthew 5, verse 9. Tonight, I don't have the exact times on when everything's going to happen, so look at your bulletin or watch the announcements at the end of the service to get the times. But tonight, we're going to be hosting the annual celebration for our local network of churches in Northeast Florida. That means they're all coming here. So we want to make a good impression on them. We want them to see what God is doing here at First Baptist and just see the kind of people that we're reaching and what's going on. So if you would, if you're not already committed somewhere else, if you could be here tonight for our service at 6 p.m., it's going to be a great service. We're going to be leading everything. Our praise team's going to be leading worship. I'm going to be preaching. It's going to be a First Baptist kind of event. So be here, hear about what God's doing in all the other churches. There's a meal preceding the service, so you can get all that information in your bulletin or in the announcements. But if you can at all be here, it would mean a lot to me, and it would help us to put on a good face for the association and let them see how God is blessing this model of ministry. There's a couple of other churches that are doing a more modern approach to ministry in our association. But we could be a great encouragement to them and to these other churches if you would really help us to do that tonight, all right? So be praying for it. Show up. Be fully engaged when you get here. Show hospitality to our guests. Let's make it a really, really good night. And then next week, what's going on? Friend Day, October 13th. If you haven't already done so, take that white card in the seat back in front of you. Put the first name on that white card, and then drop it in the boxes as you go out of the service, those blue boxes by the doors, and we'll get those put on the wall so we can be praying over those, looking forward to what God's going to do next Sunday. So be inviting people for that. We're talking today about the last two Beatitudes. There are eight. The eight are not eight different types of people, but there are eight characteristics that the Spirit-filled person in the kingdom of God demonstrates in his or her life in varying degrees. As you grow in Christ over the course of your journey, each of these should become more and more evident. So you don't have like, well, this guy's, he's a meek person, but that one over there is poor in spirit. No, they're all in the same person, and it's the same fruit of the Godward life. So we're talking about the last two this morning, specifically peacemaking and persecution, and we're going to talk about why they're gathered together and why Jesus gives us three verses about persecution right after he introduces us to peacemaking. Mrs. Moeller was on trial for the death of her third husband. She was talking with the judge and talking with the lawyer of the opposition, and the lawyer asked Mrs. Moeller, what happened to your first husband? She said, well, he ate poisonous mushrooms. And he said, okay, what happened to your second husband? She said, well, he also ate poisonous mushrooms. I said, and your latest husband, how did he die? And she said, well, blunt force trauma to the head. The lawyer said, Mrs. Moeller, what happened? And she said, he refused to eat the mushrooms. Now, believe it or not, I always run my jokes by my family on the way to church, because I know some of them are kind of corny and some of them are too corny. But I asked my daughters, I said, should I tell this one today? And they were like, no, don't tell that. And I said, why? I thought they were going to say, because it's too corny, Dad. And it's a dad joke, you know. But instead of that, they said, nope, somebody might be tempted in our church. So we're going to pray for you that nobody is tempted to take that course of action, okay? That is not peacemaking. That is, well, it's one way to get peace. It's one way for sure. It's not the best way. We're going to talk about the best way today. Peacemaking, right here in the text, is followed by three verses where Jesus says, persecution, you're blessed if persecution arises in your life. Why is that? What in the world does it have to do with peacemaking? Let's look at the text in verse 9. Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. But then notice what he says next. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you, persecute you, and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. I want to submit to you this morning that you can't understand peacemaking unless you understand it in light of persecution. Let me explain. Number one, what is peacemaking? When we were created, we were placed on this earth, our great, great to the 100th degree grandparents were placed in a situation where they made a unilateral decision to enter into league with the enemy. They trusted the word of Satan over the word of God, according to Genesis. They trusted that the day they eat of the fruit, they would not surely die. God said they would. So they trusted Satan over God. Humanity had fallen. We'd fallen into the ranks of the damned. Yet God, in his great love, sought to correct what Satan had perverted and destroyed, and he went on a quest to redeem a people for himself from the ranks of humanity. So letter B, a marvelous peace has been offered. God says, I will make peace with you. I will pay the debt you owe so that we could be reunited and have a restored fellowship and relationship. Romans 5, verse 1, Paul writes, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Letter C, once we've experienced this peace, we become ambassadors of peace. So Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 5:20, therefore, we as ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us, we implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. So we were at war with God. God sought us. He made peace with us through Jesus. Now we as ambassadors who have experienced peace, we express peace to others by helping them to find peace with God. And as we do, letter D, we resemble Jesus. He says, you will be called sons of God. Very simple. But peacemaking is not peacemaking in the sense that it's just trying to make everyone get alone. It's not just trying to cause everybody to put down their weapons. That's peacekeeping, perhaps, but that is not what Jesus is talking about here. I want to submit to you today that he is talking specifically about peacemaking that is related to the vertical sense in which we help people find peace with God through Jesus Christ. He says, you become a peacemaker the way he did. He, as the great capital P, peacemaker, came from heaven, went out of his way, went to the cross so that you could be at peace with God. And then when you have vertical peace, horizontal peace comes as an overflow. And Jesus says, when you do that, you look like me. You are the little s, sons, plural, of God. You look like the big S, son of God, because you're doing what he did. You're making peace. When I go back home to Alabama and I'm going in a service station or gas station, whatever it might be, and when I walk in there, inevitably they will say something like this. They'll say, you're one of those Terry boys. I don't know which one you are, but it's obvious you're one of them. My dad was the baby of seven sons. He was the seventh son of Floyd and Stella Terry. And man, our genetics are strong. We all look alike. We all have blue eyes. We all kind of have sandy hair. I mean, just certain things we all have in common. So if I'm back there, they know where to put me. They know which litter I was born to, all right? I mean, they know because we all kind of resemble each other. I can't deny it. And in the same way, when you are a soul winner, when you are sharing the gospel, when you are investing in relationships for the purpose of inviting people to know Christ, you just look too much like Jesus to deny it. You resemble, you shall be called the sons or the daughters of God. Why? Because you're trying to help people find peace with their Maker. But the reality is, when you do that, number two, it always, peacemaking always brings persecution. We're told in Romans 8, 7 that the mindset on the flesh is hostility. Some translations say enmity. It means to be at war with God. So the person who doesn't know God is at war with God. Now, they're not consciously at war with God, perhaps. But when certain truth claims are made from Scripture, from God, God says, this is true, you can see the hostility arise. If you walk into the public sphere and you proclaim the truth according to Scripture, it will repel some people who are hostile toward God. Jesus said, if they call the master of the house Beelzebub, what do you think they're going to call those of his household? Beelzebub in the New Testament, it means Lord of the flies, which is bad enough in and of itself. I don't want to be called the Lord of the flies, but Jesus said he was the Lord, and they said, yes, you're the Lord. You're the Lord of flies. Now, that sounds bad, but if you really dig into what he's saying there, do you know what the Lord of the flies means? Flies congregate around dung. So whether it's camel dung or whatever it might be, there would be flies that congregate around it. And they would say, that was a temple to Beelzebub, the Lord of the flies. And the flies have gathered around the dung. And when they said, Jesus, yes, you're Lord of dung. Now, Jesus was perfect. Jesus was a friend of sinners. Jesus never did anything wrong. Jesus came to seek and to save that which is lost. And if Jesus was called, who never told a lie, who never had a bad thought, who never gossiped, if Jesus was called the Lord of dung, what do you think they're going to call you? You who are imperfect, you who are fallen, you who make mistakes, you who sin and repent. If you go out and you try to help people find peace through Jesus Christ, if they called the master of the house Beelzebub, what are they going to call you? It's going to be far, far worse. Peacemaking always brings persecution. 2 Timothy 3:12, indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. It's going to happen. It's inevitable. Now, when you go out and you live for Christ, specifically if you're inviting people to Friend Day, persecution is going to arise, But lest you be confused, let me make something very clear. The gospel and the spirit-filled life both attract and repel. So the early church, you see in the early church, they had favor with all the people, according to the book of Acts. But they also suffered intense persecution. Both happen. If you go to school and you're living for Jesus, if you're living for Jesus, you go to work and you're living for Jesus, some people are going to be drawn to you, other people are going to be repelled from you. If you're always repelling and never attracting anybody, you're just obnoxious. Some people just have a martyr's complex, and you just need to know that that's not because you're godly, you're just mean. Okay? And if you're always repelling and you never attract anybody, you're just obnoxious. If you always attract, and if, man, you're a friend of sinners like Jesus, and they want to be around you because you're just like them, but you never repel, you're a coward. Do you see the balance there? If you always repel, you're obnoxious. If you always attract, you're a coward. You're not speaking the truth. Let's take that corporately. A true church, a real church, will do both. God will give us a measure of favor with our community, and they'll look at us and they'll say, you know what? The community's better because that church is here. But at the same time, there will be people who say, I'm not going to set foot on that campus because you know what they believe? They believe that antiquated 2,000-year-old Bible. And from a different culture on the other side of the earth, and they try to hold that up as if it's true here in this progressive community. They try to hold that up as if it's a legitimate truth claim. So on one hand, a true church will attract people, and on the other hand, a true church will repel. Both have to be true. If it's a church that's always repelling everybody, that's an obnoxious church. But if it's a church that only speaks nicey-nicey chicken soup for the soul, strokes your ego, tickles your ear, tells you how wonderful and great you are, and just always says the nice thing, that church and that pastor is a coward. Both are true of a genuine church, a genuine ministry. And if it ever gets off balance, it needs to be corrected. So here, you see that the person who is seeking to bring others into a peaceful relationship with God are going to attract some, they're going to repel others. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 2:15 that we are an aroma of life unto life to those who are being saved. We're an aroma of death unto death to those who are perishing. It's the same bottle. It's the same perfume. Some love it, some hate it. It's not for everybody. God help the church that everybody wants to be a member of. This church is not for everybody. And listen, for some people, they're going to hear the same sermon you hear, and they're going to be repelled. And that's reality. That's just true. So in the personal, when you live a life for Jesus and you try to bring people to peace with God, there are some people that are going to love you for it, and some people are going to hate you for it. That's just reality. And anything less than that is not honest. But Jesus says you should rejoice when it happens. And that's hard to do. It's hard to say, yes, they hate us. Yes, I didn't get invited. Yes, my girlfriend broke up with me or whatever it might be. Because I love Jesus. That's hard to rejoice in those things. I lost 10 followers for standing up for Christ on Facebook. It's hard to do that, but Jesus says that's how you should respond. In his book, it was written several years ago, Mark Cahill, Alabama native, he's from Auburn University, which in Alabama we call them the mission field, but nevertheless, back in Alabama, he wrote this book, and it was called The One Thing You Can't Do in Heaven. And he had two premises of the book, basically. He said, on the first hand, he said, everything you do on earth for God, you can do better when you get to heaven, except for win people to Jesus. So, for example, if you sing here, our praise team, they sounded awesome. They all did a wonderful job. But can you imagine in heaven with glorified lungs? They won't need an amplifier. It will be incredible. You, who maybe some of you say, man, I couldn't sing if I had to. I can't carry a note in a bucket. But in heaven, you will be able to. Down here, you may feel ignorant to the things of God. But in heaven, when you've been in heaven 5 minutes, you'll know God far better than I ever have. You will know as you are known. Everything you do here, you give here, you'll give better in heaven. You serve here, you will serve better in heaven. Everything you do here, you'll do better in heaven. So it begs to ask, why are we still here? Why doesn't God take us on to heaven? Because there's one thing you cannot do in heaven. You cannot share the gospel with somebody who doesn't know Jesus. They're not there. They're not in heaven. If they're lost, they're not in heaven. So God leaves you here where you do subpar work from what you eternally will do, so that you can do the one thing you can't do in heaven, and that is be a peacemaker. Help people find that peace with God through Jesus Christ. Now, if you do that, if I'm successful today, and you take this to heart, and you say, okay, I'm going to go out, and I'm going to start sharing my testimony, I'm going to start witnessing, and at the very least, I'm going to go out and find somebody and invite them to Friend Day. At the very least, I'm going to find my one that I can bring to church next week. There are three possible responses to that. One, they might get saved. I mean, can you imagine that? Can you imagine if because of your influence, because you reached out to them and you invited them to church, can you imagine if they got here, got to thinking over what's said, and they come to faith in Jesus, and they're saved, they're set free, they're delivered, they're on their way to heaven, their whole family's legacy has changed because of your influence. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? You're like, I don't know, I don't. You trick us sometimes, Pastor. I'm not real sure. This is no trick. If they get saved, if somebody gets saved, is that good or bad? Good answer. Okay. Now, second possibility. They may not get saved. You may just plant a seed. You could at times plant a seed, and that seed has to be watered, and it has to be fertilized, and it has to be tended to. And it may be a decade. It may be 5 years. It could be weeks. before it ever bears fruit. But still, you got the seed planted. Is that a good thing or bad thing? Now, third option. They may hate you. They may unfriend you on Snapchat. They may start telling people things about you that aren't true at school. They may walk through the neighborhood and label you as the fanatic. That could happen. They could reject you and never come back to church again and just spend the rest of their life telling everybody how sorry you are. Is that good or bad? I got a little mixed response there. According to Jesus, it's good. Jesus said, blessed are you. Rejoice. Man, you go down to Nana Teresa's and buy you something good. Because congratulations, you were persecuted for the gospel. And what a good thing that is, Jesus says. He says, when you seek to make peace, help people to find peace with God, then it results in persecution. Rejoice in that day and be glad. He said, in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you, you're in really good company. So there's not a bad response. If you're faithful to invite and share and plant seeds, whether they get saved, the seed is planted, or they reject you, it's all to your benefit. Your heavenly bank account. If you go down to the beach today and you witness to somebody and you just say, man, let me tell you what God has done for me. Did you know that God sent His Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for my sins and your sins? And because of faith in Him, I've been forgiven. And if they laugh at you and reject you, it's like you need to hear in the back of your mind, cha-ching, your bank account, your stock in heaven just went through the roof. You see how that works? There's no bad response to a gospel witness. It's always good. In Seoul, South Korea, the largest church of the world is pastored by a man named Paul Yanni David Cho. Pastor Cho, tens, hundreds of thousands. I mean, the category that this particular church is in, it's really difficult for us to wrap our minds around. They have so many people each week praying to God and learning the Bible, and that it's the largest church on the planet. Somebody asked him one day, Pastor Cho, to what do you attribute this incredible growth? And he smiled and he said, it was the former pastor. He said, the former pastor, before I ever came along, he kind of came under some hostility from the local mafioso of Korea. Apparently, that's where they develop a lot of opium, and they have these opium fields, and when the church would prosper, the drug industry would suffer. So they came to him and made him an offer they thought he could not refuse. They said, you need to stop preaching. He refused. Then they took his family and brought them to, if I remember right, it was like a pit. They put him in a pit, and when high tide came in, that pit would fill with water. He put the family in the pit and said, you either recant and refuse to preach, or they die. Children, wife. The story goes that as the water was rising and the babies began to cry, the mother patted them on the head and said, hush, my children, we've been invited to a great banquet tonight. They all died. The man kept preaching. And when Pastor Cho was asked, to what do you attribute the success of this church? He pointed to two deacons. He said, those were the hit men. But we stayed faithful. We kept preaching the gospel. They ultimately came to faith in Christ, found peace with God. And their testimony is what is drawn people to this church year after year after year. Peacemaking brings persecution, but if you're patient, the church will prosper. You want God to use you, don't you? You want God to powerfully use you for the glory of God. Are you willing to pay that cost? so far away. That's so hard to relate to. It's, I get it, Pastor, but man, that's on the other side of a planet. That's years ago in a different culture. It's just so hard for us to connect with that. How about this? This week, Amber Geiger was on trial for walking into an apartment she thought was her own. She saw a black gentleman in the room and opened fire on him, taking his life. It was a mistake. By her testimony, it was totally an accident. Previously, that day, as they did research, they found that there were racist tweets on her phone or messages on her phone and some very inappropriate, obscene kind of text messages on her phone. So it was incriminating, but nevertheless, she said that this was totally a mistake. She didn't mean for this to happen. And probably, if you've been watching the television or social media, you've seen the embrace that the deceased brother gave to Amber and said, I'm going to forgive you and I love you, and he embraced her in the courtroom. You've probably seen that. But most of the mainstream news outlets didn't give you his entire witness and his entire testimony of why he would make peace with her. And I want to correct that for you today, so watch this if you would.
I can speak for myself. I forgive you. And I know if you go to God and ask him, he will forgive you. And I don't think anyone could say it. Again, I'm speaking for myself, not even behalf of my family. But I love you just like anyone else. And I'm not gonna say I hope you rot and die just like my brother did, but I personally want the best for you. And I wasn't gonna ever say this in front of my family or anyone, but I don't even want you to go to jail. I want the best for you, because I know that's exactly what both of them would want you to do. And the best would be give your life to Christ. I'm not gonna say anything else. I think giving your life to Christ would be the best thing that both of them would want you to do. Again, I love you as a person. And I don't wish anything bad on you. I don't know if this is possible, but can I give her a hug, please? Please?
Yes.
Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. What you didn't see as well was that Judge Kemp, after that happened, she took the courtroom Bible and walked down, laid it in front of Amber Geiger, opened it to John 3:16, and said, start there. The key to peace with our fellow man, horizontally, is peace with God vertically. It all starts there. Now, when it happens, some hear that and they're attracted to it. Others hear that and say, that judge doesn't need to be on the bench anymore. To some, it's an aroma of life. To some, it smells like death. And the same will be true of you if you're faithful. Be faithful. It's worth it. Let's bow our head and close our eyes. With heads bowed and eyes closed, let me just say in way of reminder, be who you are. You're a follower of Jesus Christ. Act like it. Represent Him, whatever comes from it. Never be ashamed. Never compromise. Never be a coward. It will attract some. It will repel others. But that's not your business. If you're here today and you've never met Him, we can introduce you to the same Savior that was introduced to Amber Geiger. You can meet Him today. So I've never killed anybody. Yes, you have. It was your sin that put Jesus on the cross. And you're guilty, and I'm guilty. We need a Savior. So if you're ready, and if God's brought you to that point that you're ready to give your life to Christ, to own Him as Lord of your life, to turn from your sins, repent of your sins, and by faith come to Jesus, then we're ready to introduce you to Him today. For others of you, just like in our first service, you're here and you say, Pastor, I'm attracted to the truth. I'm drawn to the truth. And it is the preaching of your sermons, scripture-based sermons, that edifies my soul. And I'm here to unite with this family of faith, to become a part of this team, this tribe. And say, let the results be what they will. I want to unite with this family of faith. If that's where you're at, then it would be our joy and our pleasure to welcome you into our family this morning. As I pray, make up your mind. If you need to be saved, you come and just say, I need to be saved. If you're here and you need to join our church, just let myself or one of these other pastors know that, and we'll help you with that decision. Father, in Jesus' name, I'm so thankful to be a part of a church that loves the truth, that stands on the truth, that says we're going to be true to our Lord and let the results be what they will. Father, I thank you that you have blessed that throughout the years. Some are drawn to it, some are repelled from it, but Lord, that was the shoes you walked in. So God, may we be faithful to you. Help those who need to come today. Give them the courage. And may they trust you as they do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand to our feet. As we stand, you come.
Good morning and welcome, friends. We are so glad that you chose to worship with us this morning. It wouldn't have been the same without you. My name is Josh Wood. I'm your student director, and here's some things that you need to know. Next Sunday, October 13th, is Friend Day right here at First Baptist, and we are encouraging everyone to go out and invite their friends, invite your neighbors, your coworkers, your classmates, everyone that you can think of, and invite them to come back and worship with us next week. It's going to be an incredible day. To help you, we have invite cards. You can pick them up at the Welcome Center, the Children's Desk, and you should also get some in small groups today too. Next Sunday, October 13th, is going to be an amazing day. Have you looked at your calendar lately? It is October, and that means October 31st is our trunk or treat. It's going to be an incredible time, and we want to encourage everyone to be involved. It'll be located in the back parking lot, and it's a great opportunity for our families to serve other families in the community. We've planned an evening filled with fun from start to finish, and we need your help to finish out the fun activities by providing a trunk. You can sign up to do a trunk online at fbfirst.com. Hey guys, tonight is the Northeast Florida Baptist Association annual meeting, and it's right here at our church, right here at First Baptist, and so we want to invite you to come back and support our church, but also support our association. Pastor Zach is going to be preaching the sermon, and our worship team is going to be leading us in worship. Broken and Blessed is the theme this year, and it's going to be an incredible night, so make sure that you are here. Well, hey guys, it's been great worshiping with you guys this morning. I really do feel like we're friends when we're in this room together and we're worshiping our Savior. It's an awesome thing. Remember, Friend Day next week, and drop those white cards in the blue boxes as you leave today, because it's going to be a great display of us inviting our friends. Can't wait to see you next week. We'll see you later.